subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Good evening, welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chonsong. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Tuesday, the 31st of August. Heavy rainfall wreaks havoc in India's Maharashtra, affects normal life in New Delhi. Taliban celebrate victory as last US troops leave Afghanistan. And locals in Pakistan's financial capital slam Prime Minister Imran Khan's government for rising inflation. And now for all the details. Heavy rainfall lashed Indian capital New Delhi on Tuesday, leading to severe waterlogging and traffic congestion in several parts of the city. Meanwhile, at least one person was killed due to floods in Jalgaon district of Western Maharashtra state on Tuesday. Rescue operations continued as a landslide also occurred in the district, which has been badly hit by incessant rainfall.
Heavy rains lashed parts of Indian national capital New Delhi on Tuesday, leading to severe waterlogging and traffic congestion in the city. Residents complained they faced huge problems in commuting to their destinations as traffic snarls were witnessed in several areas. Excessive monsoon rains this year have affected many parts of India, throwing normal life out of gear as civic administrations often fail to cope with challenges posed by them.
लेकिन दिल्ली की जो सड़कों पे इतनी पानी लगी हुई है, उसे देख के तो किसी की हालत नहीं होगी कि निकल सके। फिर भी मैंने अपनी कोशिश की कि चलो मैं निकलता हूँ, मुझे जॉब करना है। जॉब करने के लिए मुझे 2 से 2.5 घंटे लग गए सिर्फ पालम के फ्लाईओवर क्रॉस करने में।
Meanwhile, at least one person was killed and several were reportedly missing on Tuesday due to floods in Jalgaon district of India's Western Maharashtra state. Rescue operations were underway as a landslide also occurred in the district, which has been badly hit by incessant rainfall. The flood situation also remained grim in India's eastern Bihar and northeastern Assam as major rivers flowed above the danger mark, inundating several villages and affecting thousands of people in both these states.
The United Nations Security Council under India's presidency adopted a strong 7-point resolution on Afghanistan, demanding that the Afghan territory not be used to threaten or attack any country or to shelter or train terrorists. The resolution also demanded that the Taliban uphold human rights, provide safe passage to those who want to leave Afghanistan, and allow humanitarian aid.
The United Nations Security Council under India's presidency on Monday adopted a resolution on Afghanistan after Taliban's return to power, focusing on counter-terrorism and humanitarian assistance. It called on the Taliban to honor its commitments to allow Afghans and foreign nationals to leave the country, who continue to remain stuck in Kabul. The UN Security Council demanded that Afghan soil should not be used to attack any country or to shelter terrorists, even as American forces completed their drawdown in Afghanistan a fortnight after the Taliban takeover. India's Foreign Secretary Harshvardhan Shringla, in his remarks to the media at the UNSC, said, "This is of direct importance to India."
I was in particular very happy to preside over the adoption of today's important resolution on Afghanistan, which has unequivocally conveyed that Afghanistan's territory should not be used to threaten or attack any country or to shelter, train terrorists or plan or finance terrorist acts.
India's greatest security concern is the presence of fighters from Pakistan-based terror groups such as Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed. A number of terrorist leaders, including those with links to Al-Qaeda, have resurfaced in Afghanistan. Meanwhile, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi has formed a high-level group in view of the situation in Afghanistan, comprising Foreign Minister S. Jaishankar and the National Security Advisor Ajit Doval. The group will focus on evacuations and the ground situation.
In a chaotic airlift nearly 20 years after United States invaded Afghanistan in response to the September 11, 2001 attacks on America, the United States on Monday said it had completed the withdrawal of its forces from Afghanistan, leaving the Taliban stronger than their previous rule from 1996 to 2001. Celebratory gunfire echoed across Afghan capital Kabul before dawn on Tuesday, after the last US troops took off from the airport. Celebratory gunfire echoed across Kabul before dawn on Tuesday after the last US troops took off from the airport, ending 20 years of war in Afghanistan that left the Taliban stronger than it was in 2001. Final flights transporting the last US troops took off a minute before midnight, marking the completion of the US pullout that ended America's longest war. Fireworks and tracer bullets lit up the night sky in Kabul after final flights departed from Hamid Karzai International Airport, with one of the aircraft deploying flares as it took off. General Frank McKenzie, commander of the U.S. Central Command, told a Pentagon briefing that the chief U.S. diplomat in Afghanistan, Ross Wilson, was on the last C-17 flight out.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm here to announce the completion of our withdrawal from Afghanistan in the end of the military mission to evacuate American citizens, third country nationals, and vulnerable Afghans. The last C-17 lifted off from Hamid Karzai International Airport on August 30th this afternoon at 3:29 p.m. East Coast time.
Later in a speech hours after withdrawal of the last U.S. troops from Kabul Airport, Taliban spokesman Zabihullah Mujahid told members of an elite Taliban unit on Tuesday that Taliban soldiers should treat the people well and they have the right to peace. Forced into a hasty and humiliating exit, Washington and its NATO allies carried out a massive but chaotic airlift over the past 2 weeks, but still left behind tens of thousands of Afghans who helped Western countries and might have qualified for evacuation. The 20-year conflict took the lives of nearly 2,500 U.S. troops and an estimated 240,000 Afghans and cost some $2 trillion U.S. dollars.
In news from Pakistan, Pakistan's Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi on Tuesday held talks with his German counterpart Heiko Maas in Islamabad and discussed bilateral ties and the evolving situation in Afghanistan. Both the leaders said they now expect the Taliban will soon form an inclusive government in the war-torn country.
Pakistan's Foreign Minister Shah Mahmood Qureshi on Tuesday met his German counterpart Heiko Maas in Pakistani capital Islamabad to discuss bilateral ties and the evolving situation in Afghanistan. The meeting came hours after the withdrawal of the last international troops from war-torn Afghanistan. The foreign minister said that they now expect the Taliban will form an inclusive government in the coming days in Afghanistan. Maas said Germany will wait to see if the Islamists will honor their pledge to allow civilians to leave Afghanistan on flights from Kabul airport. Addressing a joint press conference, Qureshi also stressed the need for the international community's cooperation for ensuring stability in Afghanistan.
This is a pivotal moment in Afghanistan's history. The international community must remain engaged. Humanitarian assistance must flow. Do not let the economic collapse in Afghanistan take place.
Meanwhile, Pakistan's Interior Minister Sheikh Rashid Ahmed on Monday ruled out the possibility of allowing the long-term presence of the US troops who have arrived from Afghanistan in Islamabad. He said the stay is for a limited period only, and foreigners have been given only transit visas for stay up to 30 days as part of the evacuation efforts from Afghanistan following Taliban's takeover.
More news from Pakistan. Residents in Pakistan's Karachi city have expressed that they are irked by the rising inflation in the country and blame the government for failing to control the prices of essential commodities. They lamented the economic situation has been worrying since Prime Minister Imran Khan came into power in 2018.
Uncontrolled inflation has become the most worrisome issue for residents of Pakistan. Locals in the country's financial capital, Karachi, expressed their dismay over the frequent hike in fuel prices in recent months, which has made food products costlier as they are transported via road. They blamed poor people have been squeezed dry trying to survive the inflation and complained that government does not understand how people are struggling to earn their daily bread amid the pandemic.
गरीब को गरीब कर रहे हैं, अमीर अमीर हो रहा है हमारे मुल्क में. हमें तो समझ में नहीं आ रहा ये क्या हो रहा है. पेट्रोल पे कीमतें बढ़ रही हैं, आटा महंगा, दालें महंगी, सब्जियां महंगी. खाएंगे क्या हम? हवा खाएं या क्या खाएं? हुकूमत हमें ये भी बता दे कि हम क्या खाएं.
सर ये एक चीज़ महंगी नहीं होगी, हर चीज़ महंगी होगी है. जब से इमरान खान की हुकूमत आई है तो आवाम जो है जलील और बदकार हो गई है. उससे पहले लोगों का गुजारा चलता रहा, अभी तो कोई गुजारा भी नहीं चल रहा.
Meanwhile, a recent report by Pakistan's finance ministry has stated that the inflation may inch over 9% due to monetary expansion and a spike in international commodity prices. It said the current account deficit could remain over $500 million in August, risking the economic situation further.
Bangladesh's first metro rail in capital Dhaka made the trial run Sunday on a section of the 20.1 kilometer project known as Mass Rapid Transit Line 6 or MRT6. The test run was flagged off by Bangladeshi Road Transport and Bridges Minister Abdul Qadir at its depot in Dhaka. The train, consisting of 6 carriages, made the trip from its depot and back after crossing 3 stations on its way without any passengers. According to the minister, if all trials and inspections go well, the train will be launched for public use next year in December after completing multiple stages of test and trial runs. The second phase of the performance test will begin in a few months from now. Dhaka Mass Transit Company Limited, a Bangladeshi state-owned enterprise founded to implement the metro rail lines across Dhaka, is constructing the metro rail line, divided into 8 packages in collaboration with companies from China, Japan and other countries. Gatka is a traditional form of martial arts which was introduced by Sikh religious leaders in the 15th century among their followers. Recently, a state-level championship of Gatka was held in India's northern Jammu and Kashmir territory to promote the sport among the youth of the community.
A local Sikh martial arts association organized a state-level championship of their traditional war game called Gatka in Jammu city of India's Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir this past weekend to promote the sport among the youth. Several youngsters enthusiastically participated in the Virasat-e-Khalsa Gatka competition held at Gurdwara Nanak Sahib in Jammu, wearing their traditional attires in distinguishing colours. The practitioners of the sport, which is used for self-defence, said the government should promote it at international level, such as judo and taekwondo. They said they believe that practicing such martial arts also keeps one away from social evils like drug addiction.
आना चाहिए ना, देखो जैसे सारी गेम स्पोर्ट्स में हैं और ये हमारी इंडिया की अपनी गेम है, कहीं बाहर की नहीं है. ये सेल्फ डिफेंस से हमारे गुरुजी ने चलाया था हिंदुस्तान की रक्षा के लिए. कितनी देर मतलब इसको नहीं प्रमोशन मिलेगी, फिर कहाँ पे मिलेगी? सारी गेम जा रही हैं छोटी छोटी, जैसे सिलम्बम, फेंसिंग, ये भी इसी के बीच में से निकली है ना. पर गतका जिसको देख के जो गेम निकली, वो गेम क्यों पीछे रहे सर?
Gatka was introduced among Sikhs in the 15th century by their sixth religious leader, Guru Hargobind Sahib, for the defense of the masses. The Gatka Association aims to organize a world championship for the sport. The Indian government had recognized Gatka as a national sport in the year 2016.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude, the top stories once again. Heavy rainfall wreaks havoc in India's Maharashtra, affects normal life in New Delhi. Taliban celebrate victory as last US troops leave Afghanistan. And locals in Pakistan's financial capital slam Prime Minister Imran Khan's government for rising inflation. Now our viewers can watch the show on SouthAsiaNewsline.com. You can also visit us on Facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter at AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
TAG TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.